You are listening to a sermon by Pastor Christopher Sally of New Life Christian Fellowship Church.
Pump your brakes. Yeah. Chickity check. Yeah. So chickity check yourself before you wreck yourself.
So chickity check yourself before you wreck yourself.
Come on, check yourself before you wreckity wreck yourself.
Yeah.
So chickity check yourself before you wreck yourself.
So chickity check yourself before you wreck yourself.
Yeah, because living in sin is bad for your health. Amen. Turn that off. You didn't know you could play Ice Cube in church, did you? Just a little, just at the end. When I handed that my phone to Colin, I said, listen, this is almost like a bomb. You mess around and push the wrong button or move something back, we'll have to clear this place out. But just the check yourself, wreck yourself part at the end. That's all we need. And then the rest of that, we have to leave outside of here. Amen. But I wanted you at least to know that you need to check yourself before you wreck yourself, because living in sin is bad for your health. Amen. Amen. So that's where we are today. We are talking about spiritual warfare, and we are talking about our action plan for the battle. And we talked last week about using discernment. Amen. The last 2 weeks, actually, we talked about using discernment, and we were looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 2, and we talked about the need for it and the nearness of it, and we talked about the nature of it. And then most importantly, for our application, we talked about the negation of it. Amen. Being carnal instead of spiritual, being able only to digest milk instead of meat, doesn't get us in a place where we're able to be fully utilized by God or to hear from God. And there are all kinds of ways that we move away from God and cannot hear him. Amen. It's not that he can't get a message to us or that he's not sovereign. This is not a questioning of his sovereignty, but he chooses to operate in such a way where he allows our free will to have a say in how we interact with him. Amen. And free will has messed up more stuff going than anything. Amen. Those two words together are just it for a believer. Free will can be terrible if that free will does not lead you to follow what God has revealed as truth and obey it. Amen. And so we have to be able to use discernment. And we talked about being able to the specific endowment of the gift of discernment that comes to some believers as God has gifts in the body of Christ. But that general endowment of discernment where every believer who is in the body of Christ has the Holy Spirit. Therefore, we have the mind of Christ. We can understand things because they are spiritually discerned. And how can we understand it? Because we have the Spirit. And that's an awesome thing to understand. It is near. It's available. The availability of it, the capability of it. But we also have to understand the vulnerability of it. Amen. And so we don't want to be in a place where we are negating God's ability or our ability to hear from God. And particularly in a spiritual warfare context, it's important to be able to know whether the source of a direct encounter with the spiritual forces of darkness or in a manifestation of spirit is of human, divine, or satanic origin. Amen. So just remembering that, again, that's part of the action plan. But there's another element that we need to review and talk about. And that's where we land today. And it's not about using discernment. It's about reclaiming lost ground. It's about reclaiming lost ground. No matter what you may hear or think or have been exposed to, the focus of any war is squarely on territory. They can claim, we can claim you're fighting for love, you're fighting for honor. That is, war is about territory. Amen. It's about territory, defending it and taking it. And so literally, because land is a finite resource, except in China where apparently they're building islands out in the South China Sea that we're trying to fight over. It's like, hey, you can't build any new land. That's not fair, because land is a finite resource. This is all we have. And so if I yield land to you and you take it, it's always a zero-sum game. And so that's why you can't peacefully coexist. And that's why when you talk about, America talks about manifest destiny and moving into the Old West, somebody had to lose. The Native Americans could not keep the land, and we expand in the land at the same time. And so that's why you have to have a conflict, because war is about what? Territory, defending it and taking it. The same is true in our spiritual battle. It is the kingdom agenda to advance against Satan and the powers of darkness. That's what we are told to do. We're not just supposed to defend territory. We're actually supposed to take territory. Matthew 16 and 18, Jesus, and that's the, this is when, in 16 and 18, when he says, Whom do men say that I am? Starting in verse 50. And Simon Peter answered and said, Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered and said unto him, Blessed art thou, Simon, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it, but my Father which is heaven. And I say unto you that thou art Peter, and upon this rock, your confession, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. So hell has the gates in that illustration. And he says, when I build my church, the gates of hell will not be able to prevail. We will take territory from hell. You're supposed to be advancing the kingdom agenda wherever you go. And you have to understand, and I have to understand, that's about territory. Either you're yielding it or you're taking it. But somebody is doing something with territory every day in your life. And when you think about your life as territory or domain where you're supposed to rule, where we're supposed to dominate, where we're supposed to be able to engage, either the enemy is winning and taking territory, or you are defending your territory and advancing it. Amen. And so we don't want to allow Satan and the power of darknesses, excuse me, in particular, to take any ground from us. And so when you think about Ephesians chapter 6, you think about Ephesians 6, 10 through 13, and you think about that, put on the whole armor of God that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. We don't wrestle against flesh and blood. Principalities and powers, therefore take on the whole armor of God that ye may be able to do what? Withstand in that evil day, and having done all to stand. So again, it's not just standing your ground. Yep, that's true. But there's also the withstanding, meaning something's coming at you. And so that there's always pressure on us to defend our territory. But then you also realize that there should be pressure on us to take the territory as well. So there's a tension that exists there. And we lose ground when we give Satan a foothold. Now Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 27 gives us a look at that. And we'll get to James chapter 4, but we won't get to James chapter 4 till next week. But I'm setting this thing up for you. Can you let me do it? Can I set it up for you? Amen. It says, be ye angry and sin not. Verse 26 of chapter 4 of Ephesians. Let not the sun go down upon your wrath, neither give place to the devil, neither give the devil a foothold. Amen. You know how it goes. A toehold can turn into a foothold, can turn into something greater than that. The same way that you know that if you just yield a little bit, some things can happen where the enemy can get in and he can begin to influence. I've often said it like this. You know, sometimes you can, if you think of your life as a car, you can be in control and you're driving and it's fine, and you can see somebody flat on the side of the road that's trying to flag you down for a ride, and then you pick up what's known as a hitchhiker. Amen. Now all they're supposed to do is ride with you. You're still in control, correct? And you got the wheel and you know where you're going, and then that hitchhiker. But Satan doesn't want to just be a hitchhiker. His plan is to turn himself from a hitchhiker into a hijacker. Amen. And while he may start out in the back seat, next thing you know, he'll be in the front seat. The next thing you know, he'll be asking you to drive. The next thing you know, you'll be on the passenger seat. Then the next thing you know, you'll be in the back seat and you won't even be going where you thought you were supposed to go. That's the whole point of a hijacker. A hijacker takes over a vehicle, whether it's a plane or whether it's a train or whether it's a car. And it says, I know you thought we were going to Cleveland, but we're not. We're on our way to Miami now. It's like, what happened? The plane was hijacked. The car was hijacked. Your agenda, the kingdom agenda, everything you thought you were going to do in your life doesn't end up happening the way it should happen because you allowed a hitchhiker to turn into a hijacker. And that's what happens in your life and my life when we give Satan a toehold or a foothold. And that's, and one of the ways that the scripture says that he gets in is through anger. Be angry and sin not. But what I'm suggesting to you is broader than that right now. You need to check yourself. Amen. Before you wreck yourself, because living in sin is bad for your health. And if you don't run a check, you will look up. And again, if we're not vigilant, if we're not focused, there are things in your life that literally creep up on you. They creep up. You know what else creeps up on you as you get older? And you and I all know what creeps up on you? Pounds. Don't pound, they creep. Pounds, they don't just, it's not like you just woke up one night you were this size and then the next morning you 30 pounds heavier. That's a progression. That's that creep, 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 creep. That's what Luther's actually talking about in that song. Creep, 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 creep. That's what he's talking about. He's talking about pounds. And we've all seen it. And then you look up and you say, how did I get to this place? Well, part of the reason you got to this place is because you weren't running checks. Amen. I wasn't running checks. Now, you could, if you got on the scale and it was 6 months ago and everything was fine, and now it's 6 months later, and that's the only time you've ever checked, I guarantee you, it's going to be some creep, 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 creep. If we're not vigilant, if we don't watch what we eat and we're not exercising, all those other kind of things, and Satan literally counts on that. He's counting on you and I not paying attention. He's counting on the fact that we will not run a check on our life and checking about something very particular, which is our indulgence in repeated sin or unconfessed sin, gives Satan an opportunity to exercise control in our lives that he has no right to exercise. Indulgence in repeated sin or unconfessed sin gives Satan an opportunity and control in our lives that he has no right to exercise, and we grant him control by our disobedience. At some point, it becomes not Pharaoh, let my people go. It becomes my people, let Pharaoh go. Amen. It's like you already out of the land. You've already been delivered from Egypt. But you know, as you look at the story of the children of Israel, they started to get it twisted and started to look back fondly on the enslavement that they had for 430 years. They'd only been out for a couple of weeks, couple of months, I don't know. And they said, man, remember when we used to sit around those pots of meat in Egypt and the leeks and the garlics and the melons? It's like, yeah, do you remember the bricks without straw and the beatings and the slavery and all the crying out that you did to get away from Pharaoh? But sometimes, especially when we think about sin and we talk about moving our lives in a different direction, we look back fondly on things that are not fond at all. Amen. And we begin to say, you know what? I just want to indulge a little bit. There's no such thing as just a little bit with sin. Let me tell you, sin is like a bag of potato chips. Jay's potato chips. Because what's the motto of Jay's potato chips? Nobody. Come on, y'all preaching now. Nobody can eat just one. Nobody. If the bag is open, you can look up and they're gone. And then you'll say, like you don't know what happened. How did I get to this place? Crumbs everywhere, laying on the couch, crumbs on your... Yeah, you know what happened. You opened the bag. You got no control. Why? Because that is what sin is like. Let me just tell you a couple of things about sin since we just together. I might as well let you know. Sin is a, first and foremost, sin, beloved, is a generator of trouble. Amen. No matter how fondly we look back at the back in the day and we can talk about college and we can talk about when we were young and we were running the streets or doing this or doing that, you and I need to know the truth about sin is a generator of trouble. Amen. The second thing sin is that you need to know is sin, beloved, is an accelerator of misery. It may start out okay and you may think that you got it under control, but you will quickly see like a little kid on a bike that's just learning to ride and it's fine on flat ground, but you get on a little bit of an incline. You've seen it happen a bunch of times, probably when you were teaching your kids to ride too, and it gets someplace and then the pedals start going faster and faster and then it starts to walk. It's an accelerator. That's what sin is. Sin is an accelerator specifically of misery. If you look in James chapter 1 and verses 14 and 15, you look and you see what the scripture says about sin. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. And when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And when sin is finished, it bringeth forth death. It's deception. It's the desire to the deception, to the disobedience that ends in death. It always, beloved, ends in death. But that's not the advertisement when you start out doing whatever you're doing. If you knew that you could die from it, then you would probably have a tendency to stay away from it. But it's like, nah, it's going to work out. Nah, it's going to be good. Don't worry about it. And just like that little kid, it's going to be fine. It's going to be fine. And the hill gets steeper and steeper. And next thing you know, it's out of control. It's an accelerator of misery. The third thing it is a dominator of the will. It's a dominator of will. Again, that's that hitchhiker, the hijacker. It is very hard to get into a relationship with sin and in your flesh and only eat one potato chip. It ends up dominating what you do. Amen. There is not a drug addict, I think, that's out there that would say, this is, I really signed up for this. All of it. I signed up for the fun part. The beginning part, when we were all hanging out and partying. I didn't sign up to steal all of my mother's valuables out of her house and put them on the street. I didn't sign up to get my car repossessed. I didn't sign up to sleep in the gutter. I didn't sign up to be involved in sexual relationships for money in order to feed my habit. I didn't sign up for all that. I just wanted the quote unquote fun part. People that are addicted to pornography say, I just signed up for a little bit of something. I didn't sign up to change my whole day around so when I'm at work, I'm literally taking chances knowing that the system is being monitored in some way, but I just can't help myself. I want to look at this and I want to look at that, and I've opened up this email and done this. See, that means that it's dominating your will. Amen? And nobody wants, that's what we call a besetting sin. When you want to do something different, but you feel like it's calling you and it starts to draw you more and more. Sin, that's how sin works. It is a dominator of the will. The fourth thing it is, man, I didn't really realize this was going to do all it was going to do. It's an indicator of selfishness. It's an indicator of selfishness. Basically, when you are sinning and you know what God has said and you want to do your own thing, you're indicating selfishness. Self-determination over self-denial. That's all it is. When we were in college, there was a group that was really popular, And it was called, and the group was De La Soul. Anybody remember De La Soul? They had one of their best songs was this song, Me, Myself, and I. And so when you wanted to be by yourself or you wanted to do something different from the group, they would say, is Steve coming out with us tonight? Nah, Steve's rolling De La. He's going De La tonight. He got something else he wants to do. De La is just the simple meaning of it's all about, today it's all about me, myself, and I. Three people. Me, myself, and I. I don't want to be with the group. I don't want to do what everybody else wants to do. I'm rolling De La tonight. That's what you tell God every time you decide that you want to go against what he's revealed and disobey him. You saying, today, God, it's about me. Today, God, I'm rolling De La. It's about me, myself, and I. It's not about the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. It's about me, myself, and I. And you form your mouth, and I form my mouth to say that every time we go against what God has revealed. And last but not least, the fifth thing it is. Again, first, it's a generator of trouble. Second, it's a accelerator of misery. Third, it's a dominator of will. Fourth, it's an indicator of selfishness. Fifth, it is a separator from God. God is a holy God. And sin will separate us from him. I'm not talking about the severing of the relationship if you are a believer in the body of Christ, but I'm talking about fellowship and intimacy, that God will not be in a place where he is dealing with somebody who is living a sinful life, and particularly with unconfessed sin. Look at 1 John chapter 1. When it says, if we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, verse 6, we lie and do not the truth. You can't get any more plain than that. If you say you have fellowship with God, but you're walking in darkness, you're lying. There is no fellowship. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanseth us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. Now you're lying to yourself. And the truth is not in us. So he says, so sin is going to be an issue, even as a believer. You're going to find yourself challenged by your flesh and the world and the powers of darkness that are conspiring to help you get to a place where you are ignoring what God has revealed as truth. And in those situations, this is what 1 John is saying. You've got to keep short accounts with God. And that's why in verse 9 it said, but if we confess our sins, or if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Amen. If you're in the body of Christ and you don't know that verse, you're not keeping short accounts. You should be in and out of that verse constantly. That should almost be your favorite verse. You shouldn't even have to look to see that verse. That verse is here and that verse is here. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. He says, you don't deceive yourself into thinking you're not sinning, but what you need to do is confess so that the fellowship and the intimacy and the access that you need in order to live a victorious life is available to you. And if you are not doing that, if you're not keeping short accounts, if you are in besetting sins and unconfessed sin and repeated sin, you have not run a check and you are literally wrecking yourself. And Satan is taking territory in your life. You are losing ground in this battle and you may not even know. You're losing. I'm losing because of sin. And we all know or can appreciate, those of us particularly that have come through class 101, we talk about sin, that sin should be confessed immediately, specifically, completely, and confidently. Amen. The longer you wait, the greater the likelihood that you are wrestling with something and you don't want to talk to God about it. But the thing is, when you mess up, you need to talk to him immediately. Keep short accounts. That's the recommended thing. If you offend somebody you're in relationship with, whether it's a coworker or a parent, a child, a spouse, you shouldn't really let that thing linger. The longer you let it linger, the greater chance it is that you're gonna rethink it and do some other things and get more upset. You need to say, you know what, I messed this up. Do it immediately. Amen. Do it specifically. Well, what are you sorry for? What are you asking forgiveness for? So again, we have to be specific about the things that we're dealing with when we talk to God, because we did them specifically. He wants to hear about them specifically. I told you when I was a little boy, my thing was, I got this thing covered. I literally said, I was like 8 or 9, I said, listen, I understand how this forgiveness thing works. So Lord, forgive me for everything I have ever done, everything I'm ever going to do. Straight. So I was like 8. I'm like, I'm straight. Oh no, I talked to God about that. That was last year. I got all of this covered. All of that's covered. It's like, yeah, that could work, but it's probably a better idea when you're trying to keep short accounts. And that you're not drifting, because if you don't check in, if you're not being specific, if you're not on the scale, if you don't know how many pounds you've gained, when you look up in 6 months or a year later, you'll think it's one thing, but you'll find out it's a whole nother ball game you're dealing with. Amen? And so that's why you got to keep short accounts. And let me tell you this about sin, you keeping with that illustration. Even if you know what's going on and you know where you are on the scale, that doesn't mean that it makes it any easier to do what you need to do. It just lets you know what you need to do. Now you need the strength to follow through on what you need to do. That's a whole different ballgame, but you won't even follow through on it if you don't know about it. So that's why it's immediately and specifically, that's where it comes in with completely. Amen? You have to confess things completely. What we often want to do is the easy stuff, we do that first. Just like with the laundry, we do the easy stuff first. But there could be a load that you have put off, come on somebody, that you haven't done because you say, I don't want to deal with everything. See, come on, the baseball people know. The baseball people know that uniform with all of that dirt and all of that stuff, the thing I got to do with the fail soap, and I might have to wash it over and over again to try to get that thing right. Sometimes I say, I just don't even want to deal with that. Just set that to the side. I'll do everything else but that. Amen. When it comes to sin, you can't set it aside because it'll get worse and it'll stink up your whole laundry room. You got to deal with that at some point. And knowing you have to deal with it and dealing with it are two different things. But you got to deal with it completely. And then when you've done that, then you can do it confidently because he said, I will cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Part of the power of the enemy is that he is always looking to blackmail you and influence your behavior by telling you you're not worthy of the kingdom. And you know what you say to him when he says, I'm not worthy of the kingdom? You're right, I'm not worthy, not by myself, but in his righteousness. That's what I'm clothed in. I can stand complete in his righteousness, and he's given me a job to do as a kingdom person, and I'm going to do my job. So my ministry doesn't stop because I've sinned and I've messed up and now I've been restored. I can move on confidently knowing that God has cleansed me of all unrighteousness. Check yourself before you wreck yourself. Listen, in the book of Joshua, and this is probably where we're going to have to stop here. In the book of Joshua, it's such an important book because, as I told you before, you battle where your blessings are. Amen. And so the whole book of Joshua is about territory. And if you read the book and you start out in Joshua chapter 1, you notice that God literally says, I have given you the land. Every place you set your foot is yours. That's already been arranged in the heavenlies. That's the same thing as us saying the victory is ours. We're not fighting for victory, but we are fighting from victory. Amen. He said, every place you go, it's yours. I've given you the land. He says to Joshua, only do what? Be strong. Amen. Be courageous. Amen. He says, good courage. That thou mayest observe to do all the according to the law. Have I not commanded thee? Be strong and of good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with thee whithersoever thou goest. Wherever you go, and that land is yours. But you will see time and time again, and I got four references here, but I won't mention all of them. I won't go to all of them. But Joshua 15 and 63, Joshua 16 and 10, Joshua 17 and 17, Joshua 18 and 1. You see this thing where the children of Israel and these individual tribes, where they've been given an allotment of land, you'll see something disturbing like this. In Joshua 15 and 63, it says, as for the Jebusites, and they mentioned a bunch of different ites that were hanging around in the land. As for the Jebusites, the inhabitants of Jerusalem, the children of Judah could not drive them out. But the Jebusites dwell with the children of Judah at Jerusalem unto this day. Joshua 16 and 10. And they drove not out the Canaanites that dwelt in Gezer, but the Canaanites dwell among the Ephraimites until this day and serve under tribute. In Joshua 17, I guess I am going to go through all of them. And Joshua spoke unto the house of Joseph and said, Ephraim and Manasseh, thou art a great people and has great power, but the mountain shall be thine, for it is wood, and thou shalt cut it down. And for thou shalt drive out the Canaanites, though they have iron chariots and though they be strong. That particular instance, you had these tribes, Ephraim and Manasseh, they'd be given this massive territory, and they were all stuck up in the hill country. And he's like, why don't y'all spread out a little bit? He said, because down there in the plains, those folks have chariots. It's hard to drive them out. He said, I didn't say it wasn't going to be hard to take the territory, but you have to take it, because if not, then you're limiting yourself to just this area when God has given you all of this. You can't be in a place where you're living below your means because you won't do the hard thing and driving out in the spiritual battle, the sin that's in your life. There's territory that goes along with that. You're living in a confined space because you and I are not willing to do what God has called us to do and be the kingdom people that drive out the sin and disobedience in our life. We have yielded certain portions of our territory to Satan by disobedience. And God is saying, you need to run a check. You need to understand what's happening. You need to understand and grasp the concept that it's about territory. Either you're taking it or you're yielding it. And if you're yielding territory to Satan because of anger, because of unforgiveness, because of unbelief, because of faithlessness, because of besetting sin or repeated sin, he is taking territory from you. And God is not please, because you are living below where he has called you to live. Every place you set your foot in the land of Canaan, he told Joshua, that's yours. And it pained him to be able to see that there were people that it says that they could not drive them out. But more accurately, it should be, is not that they could not drive them out, they would not drive them out. And there's some land in your life and in my life that has to be reclaimed if we're going to be victorious. Amen. If we're going to see all that God has for us in this territory, there's some territory that we need to take. And we'll talk about that a little bit more in depth as we look at it next week. Father, thank you for this day and this time.